Welcome to the latest from the court of the EDI Jester. Good afternoon, good evening, good morning, good all that stuff, right? How you doing, good peapods and jesterites? It's the jester reporting for duty, okay? I found a fantastic piece that I'm really enjoyed to share with you. Comes from conservativehome.com, okay? And it's an interesting piece that should really provoke conversation in educationists and across Edu Twitter, if it could get its bloody act together. Hashtag Edu Twitter. So we should share this to hashtag Edu Twitter, all right? Subscribe, like, that's the important thing. Subscribe, like. If you want to become a jesterite, you can do. Join up, man. Haha. Send me a coffee. Become a warrior teacher. The adverts are out. We're recruiting for January. We've got some great folk already. So I'm looking forward to hearing from more of you. Come and join us, people like yourself. Fight in this nonsense. So without further ado, right? This is a good take. I like a good take, don't you?
Oh, yes.
Mm. And it comes from a Dr. David Buck. Okay, now. I don't know if David's on Twitter, but thank you, David, for this article. And it says, David Buck, the special educational needs framework is the best way to respond to trans pupils in schools. Interesting. Even the title caught me. I was like, ooh, somebody sent me this. That's what happens. I get sent loads of stuff. Dr. David Buck is an independent educational psychology consultant based in Canterbury. He originally trained as a biology and maths secondary school teacher. There's a mismatch, biology and maths. I don't know why I find those two so strange. Honestly, I don't. I used to have a biology teacher called Mr. Plant. I'm serious, right? That great. If your job has anything to do with schools, you'll be well aware of the detailed and nuanced framework of rules intended to help educational professionals to do their job, to safeguard pupils, and to respond appropriately to complex and sometimes novel challenges. Here we go. And so you'd think that the recent huge increase in the number of pupils identifying as trans would be responded to within this framework. Safeguarding, with schools, local authorities, LAs and other agencies using them to fulfil their statutory duty to act in these children's best interest. You would be wrong in that assumption. Instead, under the influence of trans toolkits, with the old speech marks there, the old speech marks from David, produced by lobby groups such as Stonewall, Gendered Intelligent and Mermaids, many educational professionals have adopted a fringe ideology that sees children as boys or girls according to their self-chosen gender identities, not the sex they're born as. This isn't merely a hypothetical belief system. It is seriously harming children. Services supposedly dedicated to child protection are directing frontline staff to unquestioningly affirm children's gender identities with no need even to inform parents when their child identifies as trans. They do this without even considering why vulnerable children who may have been abused or have neurological or mental health condition might seek safety and reinvention in an opposite sex identity. Meanwhile, many schools are rewriting policies on the premise that biological sex isn't real. Sports become mixed sex, children instructed to use the toilets and changing rooms that match their gender identity, despite statutory requirements to provide single-sex facilities. Frontline staff who raise concerns about affirming children caught up in the trans narrative are likely to be told it is essential for equality, diversity and inclusion. Oh God, here we go again. Get it gone. Ugh. If they persist in objecting to it, they are likely to be condemned as bigots, and so many simply stand by as children make irreversible choices that may well regret later in life. I've said this before, and I will say it again, despite the fact that I'm constantly saying the same stuff. The minute they go for a trans identity, that's a red flag the size of Australia. The minute they do it, right? No school shouldn't be introducing this crap. Get it out. I'd make it an Ofsted instant fail. But in getting out, we've got to be aware it's not just in PSHE, it's across the curriculum. Keep saying that as well. So a question here asked by David is, what should educational professionals do in this situation? I'd argue that the entire issue of trans identification among children should be handled using the approach laid out in the 2014 Children and Families Act for supporting children with social, emotional and behavioural difficulties. This emphasises inter-agency cooperation and the wider context of a child's difficulties with the curriculum and school environment, and balances that child's needs with the impact of their problems on their peers. If a trans child's issues are sufficiently trans-identified child's issues are sufficiently severe, educational professionals should use the well-established multidisciplinary procedures for assessing special educational needs, or SEN, to those in the know. This results in what used to be called a SEN statement and is now called an Educational Health and Care Plan, or EHCP. One reason this is the most appropriate approach is that these children are very often vulnerable. Many have autistic spectrum disorders or emotional and mental health issues, including eating disorders, anxiety, depression, self-harm, and obsessive rumination there. Obsessive rumination. So important to understand the rumination. So important to understand what that is. A second reason is that the EHCN assessment, which is the Educational Health and Care Plan, The EHN assessment procedure is standardised. It requires at least 5 sources of evidence, which are then used by the local education authority for consideration of the resources needed to meet the child's needs. The necessary evaluation involves many choices and inevitably take time. Although this can be frustrating, it means outcomes are much more resistant to influence from groups and individuals with extreme agendas and ideologies. He is, of course, they're referring to the aforementioned Gender Intelligence, Mermaid, Stonewall, all of these charlatans. The history of dyslexia diagnosis in this case is instructive. For many years, the powerful dyslexia lobby co-opted the deficit-hunting tendencies of public sector support services to help parents identify their children as dyslexic rather than having learning difficulties. Teachers rarely objected, as poor teaching methods were absolved from blame for poor outcomes. The switch to a standardised statutory process not only reined in overzealous lobbying charities, but helped put pressure on schools to retrain teachers in a more effective phonemic approach to literacy. A third reason for placing the response to trans identification within the framework is that the concept of SEN has expanded to include consideration of the merits of segregation versus mainstreaming, the least restrictive environment that can be provided for the child, and not so small issue of disrupting other children's learning. Transgender identities, by contrast, are taken to override other people's rights and perceptions. Even to state this encroachment is framed as bigotry. This harms the curriculum, since it means misrepresenting basic biological facts. And it harms the school environment, since it means children of one sex self-identifying into the spaces and sports of the other, to the detriment of all, but especially girls. A better approach to trans-identified children would be to engage existing school policies on child protection, diversity, inclusion and anti-bullying, to protect them from any disrespect or bullying, and to use statutory assessment procedures for anything required beyond that. This would provide a counterweight to local authorities' promotion of gender ideology and the self-interested claims of charities that promote their clients' groups' lived experience with no consideration of the rights of everyone else. I think this is an interesting article. Go and have a look. David Buck, who is the gentleman that wrote this, I'm with you on some of it, I'm not with you on the rest of it. You didn't mention same-sex attraction, David. Right? You didn't mention it, and it's a major factor. So I'd like to know why David didn't mention it. Maybe he's unaware, but it's conservative home, so it's possible there, you know. I don't know, right, is the answer to that question. However, what I do know is this. I want what David is saying to happen, but it shouldn't be classed as trans. It's just children in distress. We cannot, David, this is my only thing I would say about this, as if I'm talking to him. Right, this is the only thing that I would say about this. David, we cannot have this concept of trans children in any format whatsoever. Any format whatsoever. Because it is deleterious to everyone. There is no upside. Right? So, fine, let them identify, but that should not appear anywhere. It should go down as delusion. Right? It should go down as delusion. That's what it should be called. A deluded belief in. We cannot have it in any way cemented or formulated into a system in any way other than what it is, which is a deluded belief system and a mental illness. That's my only thing I would say. I'd be interested to hear what you've got to say. And I'm great to see this coming from David, because I've not come across David before. And I think people are beginning to wake up and we're getting some great ideas and really informative thinking from places that we wouldn't normally expect to get it. So please do go and explore. I think it's a tremendous piece worth exploring. That's it. Come and be a warrior teacher. Stop fanning about it, a lot of you. I'll see you later.